Hi, everyone, and welcome back to Neighbors to Know. I'm Jen Pula, and thanks so much for joining us today. I want to thank all of you that have been subscribing on YouTube and all of you that have been following us on social media. It's great to see everyone that's connecting and learning and finding out about other people that are in the community in Bedford here and all over the place. We're actually international now, which is pretty exciting. So today's neighbor that I want to introduce you to is someone who has a wealth of information to share about families and the dynamics between families and more specifics into that too, which we'll find out in a second. We actually have two guests. One is canine. The other one is human. So the canine will just kind of be popping in and out. But in the meantime, we'll speak to our human neighbor today, which is Mara Briere.
Hello.
And actually, that's perfect because Max just went right on cue,
and
just like he's
Max.
Supposed to.
Max,
this is Max.
He is a therapy dog, and he does a lot of volunteer work. He's 8 years old. He's a Pyrenees Springer mix. We tell the groomer he's a Springer mix. And he's very sweet, very gentle, and his specialty is mental health.
And he's got a great Valentine's Day bandana on.
He does.
Which, I don't know if you can, well,
at some point you'll see.
At some point you'll have to just whiz through and see that, but right now he's behind the camera. Because we're so calm, that's why he's over there.
Well, he knows the cadence, because I take him with me to some of the groups that I facilitate, mm-hmm. and he knows that when there's a certain flow of conversation, it's time for him to relax. And then if somebody gets upset, he gets up and he goes right over to them, puts his head on their lap. So, I'm here for you.
So during our conversation, if one of us gets upset, well, no, right now he's just chilling out on the floor behind the camera. So all is good.
All is good.
So, Mara, you live right here in Bedford, Mass., and you have a company and a show called Grow a Strong Family. I didn't know kind of what that meant because... I guess it's kind of broad to, you know, what a strong family is. How would you describe what a strong family is to you? What your company would describe as, you know, okay, I've done all this work, and here's what my strong family looks like. All is good.
Oh, okay. Well, Grow a Strong Family is a organization that provides services to families uprooted by mental illness. So... whenever any family is dealing with a serious and chronic illness, it needs additional supports, additional tools, and additional skills. And what Grow a Strong Family does is we develop and provide those opportunities for families. And so for us, the way we define a strong family is a family that has an open mind, a good sense of humor, has an awareness that it has needs that it needs to learn. They collaborate together, that there's a sense of cooperation, that no one individual in the family hijacks the family, that the family works together, that everyone's needs in the family get met.
That sounds like utopia.
Well, there's a family scientist whose last name is Curran, C-U-R-R-A-N, and she put together the 10 traits of a healthy family. Mm-hmm. And she noticed that in healthy families, regardless of culture, there are 10 traits that they all share. And these are some of the things that Grow a Strong Family seeks to remedy in families that are typically put off center by a long-term chronic serious illness that has unpredictable cycles, just like any other serious illness has unpredictable cycles. The difference with mental illness is the onset. It's typically between 16 and 28 years of age, although it can be earlier. We know that children have behavioral health issues, which are mental health issues. But the more serious mental illnesses are typically diagnosed during the transition age years. And those illnesses include schizophrenia, schizoaffective disorder, bipolar, and the personality disorders. The personality disorders, paranoid personality, schizotypal, borderline personality, paranoid personality, they're not typically diagnosed till around 21 years of age.
Because no, it's, well, I was going to ask, is that like I know they talk a lot about hormonal aspects between that. You know, as kids go through, you know, changes as they get older, with girls tend to go through puberty younger than boys do, is, you know, and I can understand that they're going through so many changes, how would that affect things? But then I'm looking at it on the other side, when you mentioned 16 through 20, you know, mid-20s, I'm also thinking of, I mean, mothers in particular, once they go through childbirth and or menopause, and their bodies are changing again because of hormonal changes. Do you see some, like, a correlation there between hormone changes, male or female, and onset of mental illnesses?
The research suggests that those are some of the causative, that those are some of the factors that would influence when an illness might, when a mental illness might come out. It also has to do with the level of brain development. And the other issues that adolescents typically deal with, such as becoming their own people, determining their own values, separating from their families of origin. So it's a whole conglomeration of factors. The one thing we do know is that when there's mental illness in the family, there's a statistically higher likelihood of there being mental illness in future generations.
Yes.
So, for example, if we know that a parent has ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, it is not uncommon to have a child who has ADHD. If a parent has bipolar disorder or another mood disorder, it's not unlikely that a child would either. The research is very clear that when men have a substance use disorder, the likelihood of their sons developing a substance abuse disorder is higher than
really?
Statistically average. Yes.
So you hear about like skipping a generation, and I mean, I think, you know, me personally, there is mental illness in my family. I was shocked to learn recently that the percentage of people that have mental illness in the family is staggering. And I think, I know that people are just afraid to talk about it. There's like still a stigma, you know, after all these different things that as a society that we've dealt with, that, you know, to get stigmas, you know, away from, that this is okay and this is okay. And we've been aware of mental illness for how long? I mean, extremely long
amount of time. Thousands of years.
Right. And I don't understand what it is. Well, I can speculate and talk to you about that. But, you know, what is it that stigma is there? Because I think, you know, let's say, you know, you're a child and your parent has a mental illness and you're young. You don't know any better. You think that that's typical. And you grow up and you think that that's just the way things are. And then you might, you know, as you get older, you see other families and other dynamics and you realize that's not the way things are. And, you know, at that point you can make your own judgments. From the flip side of that, if you're a parent and you have your first kid, what do you know? Like, you can read all these different books about what to expect. There is no, you know, what to expect is not necessarily you have your expectations and then you bring home this baby that won't stop crying and you know, things are kind of thrown out the window. But, you know, how do you know where that line is between, okay, my kid's just crying all the time and, you know, this one says, yeah, they're just fine. You know, you don't have to overreact. Just get some more sleep and you'll be fine. Where, you know, where's that line where, okay, I think this is typical, or should I go out and, you know, get some help?
In my experience, probably the biggest issue that parents have about their children is, how do I know this isn't a developmental phase versus the onset of a more serious illness? And the answer, there's two answers, really. One answer is trust your gut. Mm-hmm. If your gut says something is not right here, trust that. Go get a medical opinion first. When I say that, before we ever do a psychiatric evaluation of any kind, you want to rule out that it is due to anything medical. So do a full medical workup, including blood work, check thyroid. Mm-hmm. You mentioned hormones and girls. And believe it or not, one of the ways to manage moods in adolescents, girls, especially if there's a family history of mood disorders, depression, anxiety, bipolar, is to put them on the pill.
Interesting.
Because the pill balances, modifies, stabilizes. So it tends to be a first step. The other thing is know your family history. If you realize that your child is behaving in ways that are not typical for his or her age compared to his or her peers, that's a red flag. That gives you some more information. So even if your gut is telling you there's something really wrong here, but I've never been a parent before, I don't know what the hell I'm doing, the next thing you can do is say, well, you can decide to err on the side of caution and just go and get a full medical workup. The other thing you can do is wait and see and talk to professionals like the teachers, the guidance counselor, if they're still school age, and if they're older, just get a handle on what your friends are telling you about their children mm-hmm. while away at school.
That's a good point, because when my children were little, there was a girl that lived across the street who was, gosh, 2, I think. And she came over and she says to her parents, "Hi, Mom and Dad." And, you know, I mean, it's a kind of a thing, you know, that girls develop quicker than boys do. I don't think that's a stigma. I think that's just factual, you know, verbally at least. And, you know, then you have your child and they're not saying, "Hey, how's it going?" You wouldn't expect that from like a 2-year-old having that kind of conversation. So, you know, that's, I guess, one part of where, you know, there could be like, "Hey, something's up." And then, I mean, for my kids, I had them both evaluated, like found out about early intervention. And I'm like, "Let's just do everything just so that we know." And then I remember getting a report back that, you know, like, "It's great that you reached out, but you didn't really need to reach out." And I'm like, I just needed to know that because I was a teacher. So it was just kind of on my radar from working with kids. So there's a therapy route. There's the schools. There's doctors, like you had mentioned. Where does Grow a Strong Family fit into that whole puzzle? Like, what can you offer as your company that you wouldn't find through therapy or medically or whatever?
We have two venues that we go through. One of the venues is an online presence, which includes our TV shows, which are taped by Bedford TV. They've mm-hmm. been very generous with us. And we do webinars and we put them on our website, and then there's surround materials. So for example, a complete module would have a TV show, a webinar, all the handouts that go with it, the links to the resources and other websites. So you want to know something about managing suicidal behavior, you can go to the website and get a whole list of information, including how to go the crisis text line, which is open 24/7. You text them about any kind of crisis. It could even be a flood or a fire, and they will hook you into resources. But there you have a complete set of tools, including a safety planning ebook, which I'm currently getting made into an Amazon resource.
This being your somewhat prototype.
Yeah, that's kind of my prototype. This is another one that I have. This is a prototype of the safety one over here. And it gives you step-by-step guide on how to build your own safety plan. One of the things that I realized early on, I had been an in-home therapist, and I worked with families who had kids with mental health issues. And my job was to work with the parents, mm-hmm. because parents still need to parent. We still need to set limits, we still need to deliver consequences, and we now have to learn a different way of reaching our children and disciplining them perhaps a little bit differently.
While still taking care of yourself.
Always taking care. Right. It always starts with yourself first.
Yeah.
So Grow a Strong Family has that presence. We also have a closed Facebook page for support, and we have an open Facebook page, both named Grow a Strong Family. Then the other thing we have is a coaching program. Mm-hmm. And in our coaching program, we meet with family members, not necessarily the person with the mental illness. We might meet with them, but only in the context of a family meeting or a family session. Our role is to customize what the needs are of the family and coach them in developing the skills and tools that they need, that they have decided, this is going to make life better for our family.
So it's not just parents. It's, I mean, because, it's, you know, in the family, you play, there's obviously different roles. Some people define their family as it's them and their kids, where, you know, it's also you and your parents or your aunt or your grandparent or however. And I mean, I feel like there's a ripple effect there, too, because, you know, your mother's mother might have a mental illness, which affects your mother, which then, depending on what the situation is, then affects you. And then you're not even realizing what's going down, and you might not know all the intricacies or not need to know.
That's what our coaching program kind of teases at and works with. So, for example, I might work with a sibling who's concerned about their sibling and how they can manage more effectively. Usually it's because parents are either gone or aging, and they're the ones responsible, so they don't have the skills or the tools. They recognize that and they seek it. Sometimes I work with adult children who are concerned about their parents. Sometimes I work with parents who are concerned about their adult children. Our age group for family support is adults, 18 to 90.
Okay.
So it really doesn't matter. It could be an aunt who's seeking more services, or a whole family. I could have a room with mom, dad, and sibling, and they'll say, well, when do we think we should bring in my brother, my sister, whomever? And I always say to them, well, that's something we need to prepare for, because we don't want to be ganging up on anybody.
Right.
But we also want to be very clear about what the purpose of the sessions are. Coaching is a service that looks at where are you today and where do you want to go. Therapy is a service that says, where have you come from? And how did you get here today? Therapy generally looks back. Coaching looks forward. Coaching is also not covered by insurance. The focus of coaching tends to be prevention and education, which, by the way, even if it is therapy, that's education and prevention, it won't be paid for by insurance. We don't work with a diagnosis with our families. We truly believe that when the families are given a diagnosis in a loved one, your son, your daughter, your parent, your sibling has paranoid schizophrenia, for example, the family doesn't need therapy at that point. What they need is information. What does this mean? What does this mean going forward? Is this person going to be independent? If not, what do we have to have in place? What kind of resources are there available to me? What does therapy look like for somebody who has a diagnosis like this?
The resources part, I think, is crucial, because, you know, I've seen people through the beginning of the process, and you don't even know where to start. You're overwhelmed by everything that's going on and not having any idea where to start. You're, you know, going through your prototype here. I feel like this should be, it's not, I mean, I know that Grow Strong Family focuses on mental illness, and you also have a part in here about divorced families, because that obviously uproots the family too. But I feel like even if you're not a divorced family, even if you aren't dealing with mental illness in your family, there's just a treasure trove of information in here that, like, you could just pick up. I mean, like, what are boundaries? That's not just for somebody that's dealing with mental illness. That could pop up, you know, how to communicate effectively. If everyone did that, oh, what joy we would have, you know? And I mean, there's certain things in here, one of which I wanted to ask you about, because you have these one-liners in here, which are awesome, because they're just enough to remember something by, instead of having to memorize, okay, I read this book and it's chapter six, blah, 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 whatever. But since it's close to Valentine's Day, you have an acronym here called KISS. Keep it simple, sweetie.
Or keep it simple, stupid.
Oh, okay.
Depending on your self-esteem in the moment.
So, I mean, I'm just going to, you know, focus on that one for a second, just because of the timing of the year. But what do you mean by keep it simple? Keep what simple?
Anything and everything. If you can give yourself permission to not let yourself get stressed out, if you could say to yourself, what is the bare bones that I need to take care of right now, today? If you can do that, especially during times when you're not stressed, then you're prepared for times when you are stressed, because you have a skill. All of these one-liners, which are very convenient, they're designed for two reasons. One of the reasons is to disengage from fights. that you can't possibly win. So that's one of the reasons. The other one is to give yourself a quick and dirty tool to use to remind yourself, take good loving care of yourself. What do you need in the moment? How do you stay present? When you start to lose that, you're not keeping it simple. And the fact is that the simpler it is, the easier it is to do.
And the smaller the problem probably seems. I mean, obviously, it's not a small problem, but what's happening right there that's triggering you or causing the issue, you know, if you kind of funnel down, what exactly is it that's going on just to deal with that?
For example, one of the things that I usually say is, if it's not about safety, then do I need to get involved in this?
Oh, interesting.
And what I teach the families that I work with is, if it's not about safety, it's not interrupting your life personally, and you don't see it interrupting anybody else's life that doesn't know how to stop it back to boundaries, mm-hmm. Then stay out of it. It's not your problem.
And that's hard to hear. I mean, you know, because it's your family, that's hard to hear.
Well, one of the things I like to say is that we focus very strongly on disabling enabling. Mm-hmm. That it becomes all too easy when a family member is diagnosed with a serious illness, and mental illness is serious, that we swoop in and want to fix and repair. We want to make it easier. We feel terrible that their life is off track, while forgetting that, hey, so is ours.
Right.
We're affected also.
Right.
And we're responsible for how we manage how we're affected. And that's why it becomes so important to have healthy boundaries and also communication. And the other thing that's so important is to keep it as simple as possible. If it's not my problem, I don't have to solve it. Now, there's a caveat to this, because in the beginning, there's a tremendous amount of case management work that families end up doing. Why, you ask, do families end up doing this? Is because since the typical onset of serious mental illness is when our children are adults, they can effectively prevent us from having an impact in their care.
That's interesting. Can you elaborate on that?
Through the HIPAA laws, through the privacy laws.
Okay.
And the current climate. Now, the HIPAA laws are looking to change, because the way that mental health has been using the HIPAA laws has been effectively keeping families out.
Right, because once they turn 18, you can, you know, they can choose to have you not involved in any of it.
However, if your loved ones have a medical issue, it is amazing how quickly the medical staff will share information with you, try to get information from you, all with the idea that this is in the best interest of their patient, your loved one.
And mental illness isn't considered a medical issue?
It is a medical issue.
Okay.
And this is something that just came out, and I just wrote about it in a blog piece and a newsletter, was that if you as a family member can advocate and say it is for my loved one's best interests, whether or not he or she sees it, for us to exchange information. Mm-hmm. As a caretaker, this is essential. One of the things you may not notice until you have an adult loved one in a facility of any kind is that there's barely any information for the family on how to manage a mental illness.
Yeah.
And they don't have a discussion with you.
Right. It's all about the, I mean, not that it shouldn't be about whoever, you know, the person is that has the mental illness. I completely understand that. But then the effect that it has on other people.
There's very little recognition that it has, mm-hmm, an effect on other people. And so one of the things I coach my families to do is to say before let's say their loved one is in the hospital, and it could be any family member, but that before they get discharged, I need to participate in a discharge planning meeting, because I need to know what the medications are, what the treatment plan is, what my potential role is going to be moving forward. And if I don't get that information, don't think about discharging them to my home.
Because then you're actually living it with it, obviously, when you go home. Like, you know, they'll fix the problem, whatever, in once they're in that one institution. But then the door opens, they come with you, okay, just like having a child. Now what? You know, now what do I do when A, B, and C happens?
And that's why I say to families, always try, you are a member of the treatment team. Make sure that you have the strength to fulfill that role and advocate for yourself, because you can't do your job as a team member and as a loved one if you don't have information? And our loved ones are notorious about not remembering, forgetting, not following the protocols, not being compliant, and remembering that most of the time they are adults. But we have to kind of explore that and say, does an adult whose brain isn't working have the right to make medical decisions for him or herself? Remember what I said at first, though, the brain isn't working. Mm-hmm. And this is where there has been a diverse breakdown in the system. There are some individuals who are very high functioning, who manage very nicely throughout life with mental health issues. That's not who I work with, and that's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about serious mental illness where people are seriously compromised. Their brains are not working properly.
So let's switch over to Max, who looks like he's sleeping over there. I was hoping at some point he'd end up, you know, coming over, but we're so calm and chill, so I guess I guess we're good.
He's done his job here.
He
is
has.
Done.
But so where does Max? Yeah, where does he come into play?
Max is a therapy dog, and one of the things that he does so effectively, his specialty is mental health. When we work at the VA, we volunteer in the Veterans Community Care Program, which is veterans with mental health issues and PTSD. And the age range in that program is, you know, 20 to 98. And what Max will go in, and he, he's now eight, but before he was eight, he would go in and do tricks. But
what kind
he
of
would,
tricks?
Oh, he dances,
jumping
and he backs off, and he does circles, and he goes behind me and around me and under and through, and all the veterans.
Stay tuned for that. We'll try.
All the veterans would have their repertoire with Max, and he knew each veteran's repertoire, and sometimes he would just do it because they'd give him the treat. Pretty smart dog.
Yeah, I hear her talking about it.
Yes, he knows. Oh, he was looking to go in. So the other thing that he does is he also recognizes when a veteran is not taking their meds or needs their meds tweaked.
Really?
He backs off. His behavior changes. And it's not only for medication management. We've gone out to Kimball's for ice cream, and there was a veteran in a wheelchair with a brain injury. Max went right over to him. Hmm. The first year of our pet therapy volunteering was with brain injury people at Tewksbury State Hospital. And so to Max, they're his peeps. And we also volunteer at the Council on Aging on Thursdays because our neighbors were elderly. They loved Max. And he missed them when they moved. So we started volunteering there. Those are his peeps. And now I bring him to some of the groups that I facilitate. I facilitate Rebuilding Lives for bereavement, divorce, and life transitions. It's a group at the Council on Aging. It's free. And Max comes. He greets each person, gets them to their seat, waits for everybody to calm down, and then he sleeps.
Kind of what he was doing just now, because he was walking amongst us when he first got here and, you know, came to cut a little bit when we first started, and now he's just like, I'm chill over there.
But if we started crying, he'd get up and said, take care of us. He'll know that it's not true. He can tell the difference. But the other thing we do is we also volunteer with families who have loved ones with mental illnesses. So sometimes they'll say, we worked with a five-year-old child who had selective mutism. Mm-hmm. She didn't talk, but she loved dogs. So Max and I would go every week and visit her. And after about 2 months, she started to have his voice.
What do you mean?
She would say, Mara, it's time for me to give Max his treats. But she wouldn't use her voice. She would use his voice. And then she would greet him every time we came. And it was wonderful because she started to find her voice. And she would then start transferring the skill to me. So it was a nice process, but it took a lot of time. Mm-hmm. Max was great with her. He was great with her. He was young, and he understood that she was young, and it was the game.
So you said that you were at the Council on Aging. Do you do that routinely?
Every Thursday, Max and I are there at 11 o'clock, in the morning, and then every Tuesday night we're there 7 to 8:30, which is when the rebuilding lives group is. It's okay. Every week.
So if I'm hoping that he comes over, but I don't know if that's happening because he keeps getting closer and then sitting down. That's a great picture though, right there. If only you could see. You said you're on Facebook. What's the Facebook page that people can look for to get more information?
Grow a Strong Family, Inc.
Okay.
And then we have a private group. The best place to find that would be on our website, growastrongfamily.org.
Okay. So I want to thank you so much for coming on, because the whole point of our show is to connect people. And I think people are afraid to talk about it. And they need to know that there's resources out there for them, which is where you step in. So I'm extraordinarily thankful. I know that you like rocks.
You gave me a rock.
I gave you a rock. I know.
You gave me a rock the last time I visited.
I know, but this one has gold on it, so it's even more special. And it says compassion on there because you have compassion for others.
Oh,
I'm not going to throw it at you. You have compassion for others, and I think so that way people can have compassion for each other. And that's also the ripple effect of where it all comes from.
Thank you.
So I'm very thankful for the work that you do. And
I'm thankful for the work that you do because it's a nice way to grow our community.
That's my goal. That's what I want to. It's not about me. It's about other people knowing what's happening here, and you know,
we have a rich community.
We do, and I wouldn't have known who you were had I not been here. So it's, you know, the whole point is to connect people so that you know, and then even if there's one person out there that said, oh, and just takes a peek at your Facebook page, and then you know gets help that way, it just warms my heart. So and that's what we're here for. So.
So I would have to say, if anybody gets in touch with me through my website or the Facebook page, please let me know if you found us through this wonderful program, Neighbor to Know.
Thank you so much, Mara.
Thank you.
So we'll put some links on there so people will see what they are, and so that you can find out more about Grow a Strong Family. And thank you, Mara, so much for coming on and sharing about your organization and what you do for all of us.
Thank you.
So we'll see you very soon, actually. We have another show coming up very soon on Neighbors to Know. And again, thank you so much for watching and learning and sharing and being a part of bringing all of us together as one big community. Bye, everybody.